I invite you to stand. Psalm 113 says this: Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised. We have been created for one purpose, and that is to praise the one who has made us. The psalmist goes on, he says, "This is the Lord who is high above all the heavens, above all the nations, and his glory is above all things. Who is like the Lord, who is seated on high? He looks down on the heavens and the earth. He looks far down on the heavens and the earth, and he raises up the poor from the dust, and he lifts up the needy from the ash pit." We come to a God this morning who is faithful in whatever season that we find ourselves in. And we come this morning to praise the Lord because that is what we are created to do. And we will not experience joy unless we lift our gaze and praise the name of the Lord, which is above all names. So I'm going to invite you to praise the Lord this morning. Let me pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you that you are the God who is high above all things, that you rule over the whole heavens and the earth. You look far down upon us, and yet you are the God who raises us up from the dust. You raise us up from the ashes. You are the God who saves. And so we praise you for that this morning. Lord, fill our hearts with joy as we praise you. And that in the midst of that, we would recognize that we are tapping in to the purpose of all creation, which is to praise you and give you all the glory. Lead us this morning, we pray. Fill our hearts with joy as we praise you. And we pray all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, to whom belongs all glory. Amen.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him, Hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. 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 Let all things that Creator bless and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. 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 All the redeemed washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Christ has defeated every sin. Cast all your burdens now on Him. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Share it, sir.
He shall return in power to reign. Join to sing. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Then who shall fall on bended knee? Oh, creatures of our God and King. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Amen. We're joined together this morning to praise the Lord, to do as all creation does and has done for all eternity and will do for all eternity. We join with our voices, our whole lives, and turn them towards God in praise. As we sing, we praise Him. As people come up to be baptized this morning, we're praising the Lord. We're testifying of His faithfulness in our lives. And as we have the opportunity to give now, we are testifying of God's faithfulness, that every good gift we've received from His hand. It's just another way for us to worship God and declare His lordship over our lives and our thankfulness to Him. If you're new or visiting this morning, feel free to let the bag pass as it comes to you. This is an opportunity for us as God's people to declare, God has been faithful to me, and for us to offer part of what He has given to us in worship to Him. So feel free to let the bag pass, but enjoy and take this opportunity to worship Him and proclaim His faithfulness as we sing. give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. You give life. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You forgive. You forgive. You redeem. You bring peace to the broken. You draw near. Calm our fear by the power of your
Great are you, Lord.
Father, you are great, Lord, and you have created us to display and to proclaim your greatness. Help us to do that, Lord, not just with our voices, not just outwardly, but Lord, inwardly in our hearts. Help us to praise you this morning, Lord, as we hear from your word this morning, Lord. Strike us with it, Lord. Impress it into us and transform us by your words and by your Holy Spirit this morning, we pray. Let's pray for Steve as he comes to share with us, Lord, and to preach, Lord. I thank you that in your word, as we hear your word, Lord, we hear your voice, the voice of our great God speaking to us. I just pray, Lord, that you would transform us this morning for your glory, Lord, and in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Good morning, folks. Please take a seat. Can I echo the welcome that you got at the beginning? A big welcome to Cornerstone Church. My name's Steve. I'm one of the leaders here. And if you are here for the first time, can I give you a big, big, warm welcome? And if you are here and you're not a Christian, can I give you a very special welcome? We're so glad that you're with us. And I want to give you the opportunity to talk with me or whoever is at the front about anything that you may hear throughout the course or see throughout the course of our time together here on a Sunday morning. And you join us as we begin a new series called Origin Story. There are so many questions that we can ask of ourselves. Who are we? Where do we come from? What does it mean to be human? What does it mean to be a man? What does it mean to be a woman? What is our purpose in this world? How do we make sense of life? Is this all that there is? How do we flourish? Folks, some of these are the biggest and hardest questions that are asked by everyone. Whether that's out loud in the public square or whether that's in the privacy of your own heart and your own mind. And as we look through history, certain questions become more prominent than others depending on cultural influences or what is occurring at the time. For example, the question what it is to be a man or what it is to be a woman seems to be the dominant question of our culture today. But if you used to ask that question 100 years ago, it would have been received and understood in a very different way. However, even today, I don't think the question what it is to be a man or what it is to be a woman is the prominent thinking of the young men fighting the war in the Ukraine. I actually don't think it's the prominent question for all their families that are being displaced all over Europe because of the conflict. Now, all that being said, folks, it's still an important question. And these are still important questions. Whether they are the dominant question in popular culture or not, they need to be answered. In order for us as human beings to live and flourish with purpose and with meaning. Now, one way that people try and understand themselves is that they look back in their family origins, don't they? They look back and they have a look over their family histories and they try and plot their family tree. And from that, they seek to put pieces together that may help them make sense of life. And obviously, to some extent, that helps, especially identifying any physical traits or personality traits or even ethnic cultural origins. Now, recently, folks, I found out that my great-grandmother is from the Orkney Islands, right up in the north of Scotland, which completely explains my beautiful Moroccan sunset-colored hair and also my Viking-esque, rugged, masculine good looks. But when asking the big and hard questions like the ones I mentioned before, we need to go back to the origin of our story together. We need to see what was and what is God's intention for the world and humanity. And from that original intention, begin to answer these questions. So over the next 6 weeks, we're going to be taking time through in the Bible, specifically in Genesis 1, chapter 1 through to 3, to help us work through some of life's hardest questions. And we're going to be doing it by asking big, massive questions right at the beginning. Today, we're going to look at who made us. Next week, we're going to look at who are we? What does it mean to be made in the image of God, which the Bible tells us? We're going to see what is our purpose as human beings. We're going to look at what is God's good design, that he made us male and he made us female. We're going to look at the blessing of marriage and sexuality and multiplication and the effect of the world on the world that has, and then we're going to look at how that has been distorted. how brokenness has brought the judgment of God, and how God in his kindness has and is saving the world. And through each of these sermons, we are going to be hoping to show what God intended, how sin distorts and breaks, and how the good news, the gospel, restores. So if you've got a Bible, I'd love you to turn to Genesis chapter 1. We're going to read the whole chapter. I'm going to read it right through, and then we'll have some thoughts on it. If you don't have a Bible, there may be one in front of you. Please use that and keep it open. If you don't own a Bible, please take that Bible as a gift from us to you. It's beginning, right at the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse, and it was so. And God called the expanse heaven, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was so. Good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seeds, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which there's seed, each according to its kind on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which their seed, each according to its kind. And God saw it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the third day. And God said, "Let there be light in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons, and for days and years, and let them be light in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God said, "Let them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth." Set them, sorry. To rule over the day and over the night and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw it was good. And there was evening and there was morning the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters swarm with the swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens." So God created the sea creatures and everything living creature that moves, with which the waters swam, according to their kinds, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening and there was morning the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things and beasts of the earth according to their kinds." And it was so. And God made the beasts of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over the livestock and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth." And God said, "Behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit. You shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth and to every bird of the heavens, to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we praise and we thank you for your word, and we ask that by your Spirit, you would take your word and reveal to us the wonder of who you are and the beauty of who your Son is, for your glory's sake. Amen. I wonder if you, like me, when you see a beautiful piece of art, maybe in a gallery or in a museum, and when you see all the details of, like, say, if it's a portrait, the photographic-like resemblance of the person in the portrait, and you start thinking to yourself, how has somebody done that? How has somebody done that? Or you wonder, what was going through the person's mind when they were painting this picture? Where did that idea come from? Or maybe you just stand in amazement and awe. Folks, I don't know what would go through your mind in those moments, but I know this. None of us would think, that is a wonderful piece of art, but I don't believe anybody painted it. Folks, in order for this a painting to happen, there had to be a painter, and there had to be a beginning of the painting. Agreed? Don't disagree with me. And as we look to the Bible, as we look to the origins of creation and humanity, we see right away in the first verse of the Bible, in the beginning, God. That's how it presents itself. That's how it says itself. Before anything was made, there was God. So the question we need to think through straight away, if we're going to look at our origins and look to what the Bible has to say about our origin and it declaring that in the beginning was God, we have to ask the question, is there a God? We have to. Folks, in the last UK census, 37% of people said that they were non-religious. They picked that non-religion box, you know, the nones they're called, non-religious people. However, a report by a think tank called Theos was published after research done showing that 49% of that 37% who ticked the non-box in terms of being non-religious described themselves as agnostic, didn't know whether there was a God or not, or actually as people who believed in God or in a higher power, they just were not religious. Showing that the people within the UK holding the belief that there isn't a God are in the minority. And folks, if you were to gather and pool all the statistics from across the world, that percentage would be even smaller. See, the reason for this, according to the Word of God and according to the theologian John Calvin, is this. We all have a sense of the divine. In the book of Ecclesiastes, it says this, that he made everything, he being God, beautiful in its time, and also he put eternity into man's heart. In order for us folks to make sense of this sense of divine, and therefore to make sense of what it means to live, we need to wrestle with the question, is there a God? And the Bible says, in the beginning, God. That before all things were, God was. Yeah, but you might ask the question like I asked when I was a kid, that my kids have asked as they've grown up. Yeah, but who made God? So the answer to that question is no one, because if God was created by another, he therefore would not be God. And as you look through the Bible, what you see, and you see in Genesis 1, that God is self-existent. It doesn't begin with something before God. He is self-existent. The God is self-sufficient source of all things. Theologians will call this the aseity of God. And aseity is the property by which a being exists of and from itself. See, God does not depend on any other cause other than himself to exist. Anything else for him to be realized. Anything else for him to function. He has within himself his own reason of existence. Romans 11 says this, for from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. See, folks, what makes God different from you and different from me and different from the stars and different from all creatures in creation is that God and God alone has aseity. He exists by his own power. See, we see that God is plurality in persons. You see there in verse 1, there is God. And then there's the Spirit of God, verse 2. And then there's the creative Word of God, Jesus. John, one of Jesus' disciples, described the Lord Jesus being right at the beginning. And it says this, in the beginning was the Word, the reason, the Logos. And the Word was with God. Jesus was with God. And the Word was God. Jesus was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. This plurality, this issue of Trinity, which is a mystery that God is, there is one God in three persons, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That is the us that we read towards the end of chapter 1. This is the us, this is the our in verse 26 of chapter 1. Let us make man in our image. He is a plurality of persons. God is a distinct from his creation. There is a view, folks, that creation itself is God. That's a view in our culture. It's a belief that neo-paganism, the neo-paganism belief of that is prevalent today in people's thinking and in other religions. This will be known as pantheism. The creation is a manifestation of God, hence the worship of trees and mountains and animals and the suns. But the Bible teaches, for by him all things were created. In heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is not part of it. The creation is not God. The God is distinct from his creation. But you may be sitting there thinking, well, I believe in scientific materialism. I'm a scientific materialist. You may believe that there is no immaterial reality, no spirituality, and you definitely believe that there is no God. That might be you this morning. However, what is interesting is that folks who hold to this still believe that there is universal morality. Universal morality to what is right and wrong. They affirm things like love and hate, and that one should be pursued over the other. They are scientific materialists, yet they still hold to the immaterial of these spiritual realities. And folks, the material of creation, which is the matter and substance that science needs to exist, does not lead us away from God, but rather brings us to the reality that God exists. See, most who hold to the belief that the beginning of the world began with a big bang, the question has to be answered. Who made the big bang? It has to be answered. See, logically and scientifically, the further you explore back, there has to be a beginning with something, because a bang can't come from nothing. I've got four kids. There have been times when I've been at the top of my house and I hear a massive bang downstairs, and you run downstairs and you say, what was that? And they all go, nothing. It's childlike, folks. It's actually unscientific and requires just as much immaterial faith to disbelieve than to believe. Folks, science and the Bible are not at odds. Science is the means by which we understand the world that God created. See, God, who is distinct from his creation, is also sovereign over his creation. He precedes creation, and he rules over creation. Psalm 115 says, our God is in the heavens. He does all that he pleases. All that he pleases. Isaiah tells us, you turn things upside down, talking about God. Shall the potter be regarded as the clay? That the thing made should say of its maker, he did not make me? Or the thing formed say of him who formed it, he has no understanding? Folks, there is a God, and he is in charge. When people come and say, who's in charge here? God's in charge. Our origins start with him. We make sense of life from that foundation and that truth. Is there a God? The Bible says yes. Next question. So how did the world begin then? God created, verse 1, in the beginning, God created. See, Psalm 33 tells us, by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their hosts. See, God created the world by his word. It tells us, let there be, let there be. Theologians call this the creation ex nihilo, which basically means this: God created out of nothing. He created out of nothing. And the Bible tells us in Hebrews, by faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. See, folks, God couldn't create in any other way, because nothing existed until he made it. That means that the universe is not eternal, and there was a beginning, That God is the prime mover and the uncaused cause. He has set everything in motion. So folks, if you hold to a Big Bang theory for the beginning, it was God that caused it. And such is his power that he created all things from nothing by the breath of his mouth and word. Let there be, and it was so. Let there be, and there was so. My good friend and seminary professor, Pastor Doug Logan, said, God's authority and power are so great that when God spoke, things that did not exist yet came to be so that they could obey their Lord. So God created from nothing with the power of his word. See, right in verse 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and earth. That's like a summary statement, folks. As you read through this text, in the beginning, God created the heavens and earth. It's a summary statement that says that God made everything. And we walk through the passage to see how God did it. A summary statement, and this is how he did it. When I was a kid, my dad got me onto watching this guy. This is rock and roll in our house. We watched a guy who was a painter called Bob Ross. Anyone else know Bob Ross? Yeah? Everyone over the age of 40 is like, yeah, I know. And for those who are younger, folks, in fact, there's a documentary about him on Netflix. But basically, all it was, he'd stand there with his little paint thing, palette thing, and he'd have his canvas, and he'd chat to the camera. He had a really gentle voice. He'd go, bye-bye now, and all this, God bless, bye-bye. He'd talk really nice, and he just brought you in. And he'd have his white canvas. And he'd begin straight away with his canvas, preparing the canvas. Put a bit of blue at the top, a little light blue, and then he'd get a bit darker as you come down, a little bit of green here. And it just looked like colors. And then he would start putting and filling the canvas with all the detail and all the beauty of the painting. Folks, that's what God does here in Genesis 1. He created by forming and filling a world that was formless and void, verse 2. And he spent the first 3 days forming the canvas of the world. He created light. He separated light and darkness. He created the sky, the sea, land, vegetation on the land. And then he spent the next 3 days filling the canvas of his creation with glorious things like stars, the sun, the moon, living creatures in the sea, and birds to fly in the sky, creatures to live on land, and the pinnacle of his creation, humanity. And the purpose of creation, one of the purposes of creation, is that creation, as we looked at it, pointed to the Creator. See, Psalm 19 says this, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words whose voice is not heard. The voice goes out through all of earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them he has set a tent for the sun, which comes out like a bridegroom, leaving its chamber, and like a strong man runs its course with joy. Its rising is from the end of the heavens, and its circuit to the end of them, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. That as we to look at creation and the wonder of what we see time and time again, and the wonderful things that take our breath away, they are to point to the fact that there was someone who created. As you look at the picture in the gallery, you can't say nobody painted it. In the book of Romans, it says, for what can be known about God is plain to people, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made, so they are without excuse. Folks, the creation points to the reality of and the glory of a creator, like the painting in a gallery. But you may say, but I don't believe in this stuff, I believe in science. Okay, I said it before, I want to say it again, folks, science is not at odds with God's word. That actually science helps us explain and understand the creation which leads to a designer. When you follow the evidence, it leads to that question, what before? It leads to God. That's why many scientists and many philosophers have come to a position of believing in what is known as intelligent design. Intelligent design. See, what's interesting is there is this thing called the empirical criteria for discerning that something has been designed. So there are certain criteria that people have that has to be met in order for someone to say that has been designed by a designer. And there are three factors. Is it irreducible? Is it specified? And is it complex? So let's take this Apple Watch. All right? Let's take this Apple Watch. It's irreducible. You can't break down it, break down the watch without losing what it is. You with me? You can't break it down. If you break it down, it loses what it is. It's irreducible. It's specified. It has a purpose. What is its purpose? To tell the time. It's got all other purposes that frighten me. But its main purpose is to tell the time. If it didn't tell the time, it couldn't be called a watch. And it's complex. It can't be explained away as something. Folks, God's creation is irreducible. It's irreducible. It's specified. The specification of male and female, and as they come together, babies are born. The specification that water is H2O, hydrogen and oxygen together. The specification of all the things that we experience have not just happened. And those things that I explain and much more that you see in every moment of the day are complex. Complex. Folks, all creation is handcrafted by the Creator. And God gives and sustains his creation and all of life. That life is determined by him. The book of Acts tells us that everything moves and has its being because of God. The book of Colossians tells us that by him, Jesus, all things were created and all things hold together in him. God created all things. That's how it began, according to the Bible. Now, the big question is this: when did he do it? If you're a Christian in the room, that's the question that you want to be answered, isn't it? When did he do it? Now, folks, before we look at this quickly, there are two things that I think we need to be aware of. First and foremost, we need to be aware of asking questions that the Bible doesn't answer. See, the Bible is not a scientific document. And there are certain questions that aren't answered by the Bible that they are a mystery. They are a mystery. And there are certain questions and certain answers that people can't, with all confidence, stand on and say, that is the truth, because the Bible has a sense of mystery on those things. So we've got to be aware of asking questions that the Bible doesn't answer. Also, we've got to be careful of confusing major questions with minor questions. With what we're looking at today, the who, the what, and the why are more important than the when. See, folks, I say this so often. I say this because so often people can get hung up on the when and miss out on the significance and the importance of the who, the what, and the why. It can all be about the when, the when, the when, the when. Now, what's really interesting, folks, regarding the when did God create the world, there are 10 distinct, valid interpretations that evangelical Christians hold to. That doesn't mean that they're heretic, okay? I'm going to throw the 10 up here. I'm not going to explain them all. Have we got them there? They should be there. There we go. Brilliant. Young earth creationism, the mature creation theory, the revelatory day theory, the gap theory, the local creation theory, the intermittent day theory, the day-age theory, the analogical day theory, the framework view, the religion-only theory. And you can, if you want to take a picture of that, take a picture of that, go and have a look at that, and this is what people hold to and all the different understandings. But if you take those 10, they sit within these two broader understandings, that the world is old or the world is young. There's an old earth understanding or a new earth understanding. So the issue is this: is there evidence of an old earth? Yes, there is. That the world is millions of years old. Is there evidence for that? Yes. Because science advances would show us that. But does that old earth negate for a young humanity? No. So you can hold to having an old earth perspective according to the Bible and still hold to the fact that God created Adam and Eve. You can. Is it plausible to hold a new earth interpretation? Yes. But science would say that the earth is old. So therefore, if we look at that, it says that the earth is old. Therefore, how can it be new because of this, that, and the other? And you find this, and you find this, and the science seems to point to this. And you said, Steve, that science leads us to a belief in God. Theologians would say that there is an understanding which is the innate chronological ambiguity of creation ex nihilo, right? It means this. It was created a second ago, but it looks old. God created the world as God created the world, with the appearance of maturity, but it was created in an instant. Can you hold to that? Yes, you can. One of the reasons why you can hold to that is because the Lord Jesus Christ, with his first miracle, took water and made it into wine, and it was the most mature wine that was served at the wedding. John Piper, a pastor from America, says, the creation is probably very old, but I could be wrong about that. Folks, the Bible, not science, is the ultimate authority. And the Bible tells us the what, the when, and the who with clarity. Not the when, the what, the why, and the who with clarity. And God's word, folks, in his world, are never in conflict. Never in conflict. And most importantly for us as Christian people in the room, we shouldn't fight and divide over things. We should assume the best of each other in this situation. Amen? Amen. So when did God do it? He did it in the beginning. Next question, why did he do it? Ultimately, there are two reasons why God created a world. He didn't have to create a world. He didn't have to do it. He created it to show his glory, and he created it to bless those who he made. We can combine this in one sentence. God created the world in order to share himself with others. God did not create a world because he was lonely. He did not create because he needed us. Both of these misguided notions overlook the aseity of God and the reality of the Trinity, which fulfilled the overflowing glorious love and joy that God is. If there is a God, and he created the world through the power of his word to display his glory and to share that glory with others, that being us, then what has gone wrong with the world? What's gone wrong with the world? See, what we see in the first two chapters of Genesis, what we see in what I've just read, is what God intended. And what God intended was that it was to be very good. He actually just said it was very good. As you read through that, everything was rightly ordered for his glory and for our good. It was a perfect world with a good order and a good hierarchy so that humans could flourish in the world. And humanity, being made in the image of God, verse 26 of chapter 1, the only beings created to bear the image of God, and we'll talk more about that next week, were to have dominion over creation as vice regents to the sovereign king. Psalm 8 tells us that when we look at the heavens, the work of the fingers of his fingers and the moons, who is man that you are mindful of him? That you've made him just a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. See, folks, right at the beginning, what God created was good. Humanity walked in relationship with God in a good world where there was no pain and there was no suffering. And humanity flourished in all its fullness. But sin being the rejection of God and his word, distorted that and destroyed that, and a world that God did not intend fell into free fall. Folks, we're going to look at this more in the next 6 weeks, but because of sin of humanity, creation went into this free fall. The ground was cursed. Thorns and thistles would spring up. It would make it difficult for life. The creation was overturned upside down. The order that God had was turned upside down, and the creation world was distorted. Death came into the world, and life as we experience it now, with pain and suffering and anxiety and uncertainty and a lack of hope and a lack of peace and what comes next, riddled the world. In the book of Romans, it says, for the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, we're groaning. We're waiting. This cannot all This cannot be all that it is. Folks, what has gone wrong with the world? The world is not as God intended in Genesis 1 and 2. Sin has distorted it. But the gospel redeems it. The good news of Jesus redeems it. Which leads me to my last and final question. So what is life all about? What is life all about? I saw an Instagram video only this week. There's a young guy in the United States who was walking around talking to elderly people. People who'd retired, people that were coming to the end of their life. And he was asking them about their lives and what were the things about their lives. And then he said, what regrets do you have? And the response, the most common response was this. My biggest regret was thinking that life was all about money and all about making it. And for the majority, there was a sadness because of that regret, a sadness because of the loss that had been experienced because they'd walked through a broken world and lost people to death, a sadness because they were getting older, a sadness because of the uncertainty of what is to come, because they were on the brink of the end for them. Is this you this morning? Folks, life is all about God. Life is God-centered. It is not man-centered. If you think it's man-centered, we're not doing a great job. But God has promised to redeem and restore. See, the Westminster Confession of Faith, so it's like this article that helps Christians understand, summarizing things of the Bible. The first question is this: what is the chief end of man? It says this: the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. But the distortion of creation has caused a rift. It's caused a chasm between the goodness of God and humanity. And it blinds us to his glory. And it leaves us wandering around seeking purpose and meaning in things that are temporal. We have this sense of the divine, but we seek to live in light of it by pursuing and living for things that aren't divine. Folks, the Bible is not just God's word about the who, what, and why of creation. It is also about the redemption of the world that was in free fall because of humanity's rejection of its creator. See, the story of redemption being that God was not going to allow his creation and his people to remain broken. The story of redemption, the God of creation becomes God the Redeemer and Savior in sending the second person of the Trinity, Jesus Christ, to step into the brokenness, to step into the disorder, to step into the chaos, to redeem. To actually die the death that humanity, because of their sin, opened the door to. To die in our place. So that we could be forgiven for rejecting God who is the Creator. He died in our place so that we could be given life. He died in our place so we could know peace, that we could know joy, that we could have a hope, knowing that at the cross, Jesus dealt with what had gone wrong in the world. Paid the price of a holy God in our place. And rising from the grave, conquering sin, death, and hell, promises to return to make all things new. What we see is the redemption of that good creation. See, folks, the promise of the Bible is that God's not going to scrap it all and start again. No, God is going to redeem, restore, and he's going to renew it. Amen? He's going to renew it. This is what God does so that you and me can know and enjoy him forever. Now, folks, what we're going to see here this morning is a picture of that redemptive story. See, every person that's going to stand here is going to share. They're going to share that they come to recognize that they were blind to the goodness of God. They're going to share that God has opened their eyes to his goodness and his love. And that he loved them so much that he sent his own son to die. He wasn't prepared to leave them in the state of brokenness, in the state of confusion, in the state of rebellion, that he sent his own son to deal with all that so that they could walk free. They're all going to share that they recognize that. That they hold to that. And more importantly, by faith, they believe that to be true. And that Jesus died on the cross and that he rose again 3 days later. as the first fruits of a new creation, a new world. A redeemed world, a redeemed creation. And what you're going to see is they identify with the death and resurrection, the death and burial of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as they're pulled out of the water, they're saying that they believe that Jesus is alive and he has conquered death. And the Bible tells us that as they their old selves die with him, as he rises, they rise also and follow him out into newness of life. These people have been forgiven. Forgiveness for their past, they have peace for their present, and they have hope and a joy for the future that is only found in a God who promises to restore. See, when we see Genesis 1, what we see is the beginning that points to the end. That the Lord Jesus is going to come back, and he is going to make all things new. Right at the end of the Bible, it says this. One of Jesus' disciples, he says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne, Jesus, said, behold, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this down. For these words are trustworthy and true. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you and we praise you for your kindness to us. We thank you so much that you did not leave us and have not left us in the midst of brokenness and distortion, that you have stepped in, that the Lord Jesus left the throne room of heaven to die in our place. We thank you for that. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would open our eyes to see the origin of this story, to see you, and that by your Spirit, Lord, we would realize the chief end of man, which is to know you, to glorify you, and then to enjoy you. I pray, Lord, that today, by your Spirit, you would reveal that to people. But Father, now, as we prepare for this wonderful testimony, as we pray now, as our friends who've put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ walk in obedience, identifying with him and what he has done, I pray you'll bless them. And I pray, Lord, that we as your church here would celebrate with the angels in heaven because of this new life, this restored life, this redeemed life that is only found in Jesus. And we pray these things in his precious name. Amen. Let's stand, let's sing, and then we're going to enjoy the baptisms together.
is my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. His son not sparing, send him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. Shall come with shouts of acclamation and takes me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then shall I bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Take a seat. As much as I can. Do you get baptized here? This water is lovely and hot. Lovely and hot. So no worries about that. In fact, so much so I think my glasses might be steamed up. And that's not good. What we're going to do now, folks, is we're going to baptize. We've got seven people who are getting baptized today. You heard what Steve said. How these guys are stepping into this is a sign of what has been done for them already in and through the Lord Jesus Christ. They are celebrating that they are new creations. So what's going to happen is they're going to come up. I'm going to ask them one question about how they became a Christian. They're going to stand here at the microphone. Now, this church is full. Okay, there are faces everywhere. And as they come up, I would like to encourage you guys to put your smiley faces on just to make them a little bit more relaxed so that when they come up, they feel a little bit more relaxed themselves. Okay, so first to come up is Chelsea. Woo! Hi, Chelsea. Tell us a little bit about how you became a Christian.
Okay. Hi, I'm Chelsea. We all have our struggles in life, and if you've ever been raised in an irreligious environment, you tend to conform to the beliefs, actions, and values of the modern world. Although I was raised in this way, I always believed, even before becoming a Christian, that I was being watched over and protected by a greater power. That power, of course, was Jesus. Words cannot express the gratitude I feel that he showed me how much he loved me all those months ago and the blessings he's given me in that time as well. So I'd like to say thank you for saving me, Jesus, and for my dear friends that through him helped me when I needed it most. Thank you.
Chelsea, have you confessed of your sins and do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
And do you promise, with God's help and the help of his people, to live a life that is worthy of him?
Warm, isn't it?
Okay, so Chelsea, because you have confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Next to be baptized is Elsie. All the names rhyme today, which is cool. Elsie, tell us a little bit about how you became a Christian.
My name is Elsie and I grew up in a Christian home and I've been to Cornerstone my whole life. My mum would sing and my dad would preach. Well, I really enjoyed kids' church and learning about the Gospels and creation with my friends. But it wasn't so much about my relationship with God, but trying to have the best craft or answering the most questions. When I was about 8 years old, I began experiencing a huge amount of anxiety and a quite traumatising nightmares that happened about 3 times every 2 weeks. After a while of the reoccurring anxiety, sorry, my mum gave me a song called Peace Be Still. Song and feel the closest love of God and felt the safety I felt in his arms. Peace be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust a voice that speaks peace over me. I'm so thankful to God that I was raised in a Christian family and grew up going to church. While doing GC, I've been a very strong help to build my faith, and when I talk to people around the church, I've helped too. Me and my mum have done Costa trips where we talk about Ryan and my relationship with Christ, and mornings where I would ask my dad about what his study was about. And when he would pray for me. One morning, while he was saying a prayer, I closed my eyes and pictured Jesus with his arms open wide for me. There are many other times God has spoken to me through passages in the Bible and many conversations I've had with my parents, but I just felt like I've always believed. As far back as I can remember, I felt sure that Jesus is my saviour. I'm so thankful for Cornerstone Church and a new family I've grown to love that there is Christ.
There, Elsie, just stand there 1 second, answer these questions for us. If you could, have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Do you promise, with the help of God and his people, to live a life that is worthy of him? Yes. If you hadn't guessed, this is my daughter. That's a proud dad moment. She was really worried that her screen time on the phone was going to run out halfway through that. It's okay, I'll put the code in, but you're not having the code still. Okay, Elsie, because you have confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and because you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. to be baptized is Andrew. Andrew, tell us a little bit about yourself and how you became a Christian.
I had a 30-year drink and drug addiction, and 13 years ago, Jesus came into my life and saved my life. And I give my life to Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
I have.
And do you promise with the help of God and his people to live a life that is worthy of him?
Come on.
Oh,
that's nice and warm.
It is, isn't it? Okay, stand up this way a bit for me. Stand up this way. Okay, yeah. Not yet, because you might be too tired. He's going to squat for the next 5 minutes. Andrew, can you just... because you've confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and because you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Next up is Nathan Hellwood. Okay, so Nathan, oh, go on, go for it. Here you go. Just do it, you know what you're doing.
My name is Nathan Hellwood, and I was very privileged to be raised in a Christian household, and I grew up knowing that God loves me and that he cares for me. But obviously, I was young, and I didn't fully understand what it all meant. But as I got older, my knowledge of God grew, and I became intrigued and curious to why Jesus would die for a sinner like me. I remember being in the car with my mum when I told her that I wanted to become a Christian. And it didn't all change in that instant, but I gradually came closer to God and trusted in him as my saviour. I've got a verse on my lock screen, which it's from Psalm 143, verse 8, and it says, "Let the morning bring me word of unfailing love." Sorry. "For I have put my trust in you. Show me the way I should go, for to you I entrust my life." Isn't that boss? So many times in my life I've been lured away from God, distracted by worldly things. And I think I'm not good enough, but when I turn back to him, I rejoice to know that he is waiting there with open arms. And no matter how great my sin, he forgives us, and his steadfast love endures forever. As a Christian, I trust in Jesus and in his promises. I believe. Beautifully. I believe that he came down from his kingdom in heaven to a poor family in a manger, and to ultimately die for you and me. This is the king who I want to spend the rest of my life with.
Go on, Nathan.
This is the king who I want to spend the rest of my life with. Yes. And for eternity.
Amen. So Nathan, have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
Do you promise, with God's help and the help of his people, to live a life that is worthy of him?
Yes.
Step in, please. This is Nathan's dad. Because you've confessed of your sins, put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and because you've requested this, we baptize you now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. great, isn't he? That is great. Josh, you're next.
Go on, Josh.
Come on, Josh.
It's just a short one, short and sweet, but I come to know God through. I went seeking God when I lost a very close friend, and I didn't know who God was, and I found Jesus. That's who God was, so well, that's who he is, and that's it.
Fantastic. Amen. Amen. Questions after. So, have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Do you promise, with God's help and the help of his people, to live a life that is worthy to you?
Yeah. Right, that's all. Okay.
Josh has got a bad knee. So we're having to do this in a certain way. You turn around, you sit down.
Yeah.
It's warm. Especially when you've got your hoodie on. You know what I mean? Josh, because you have confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and because you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Yourself and how you became a Christian?
So I became a Christian when I learned about God a few years ago when I was at a low point in my life, and I believed I was saved from making a bad decision, and I got showed that there was a path that was different to anger, and it was just a dark way that I was going. And then a few years later I met the Roddy family and Lydia, and then started coming to church about a year ago, and then learned more about Jesus and how he'd die for any one of us, and then decided to give my life to God.
Fantastic. Have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
And do you promise, with God's help and the help of his people, to live a life that is worthy of him?
Yes.
Now, Alfie's a big lad, so he's going to sit down too. I'm not sure I'm going to get him back up. You okay there, yeah? So, Alfie, because you have confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and because you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Next up is Nathan. Go on, Nathan. He's got his best trainers on here, as soon as he's taking them on. Nathan, tell us a little bit about yourself and how you became a Christian.
Yeah, so I was blessed to be brought up in a Christian family. I had good Christian parents. My granddad used to look after the tabernacle in the Dingle for over 50 years. So I was always around the church when I was younger. But then as I started to get older, I started to drift away. I had one foot in the church and one foot in the world. I was living for what the flesh desires and not what the spirit desires. I'd always let down the same path of self-destruction. But I keep going down that same path, even though I knew it wasn't right. So then a few years go by, I'm just doing what I want. You know, I'm not going to church anymore, just willfully sinning. And then one day I had this really supernatural experience where the veil was lifted, and what I could only describe what I seen was demonic. And it was staring at my back at me, locked eye contact for 2 or 3 seconds, and it just disappeared. And obviously it took me back at first, because you know, I didn't even think stuff like this existed. I'd never seen nothing like this before, but it says in Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And you know, we are in a spiritual warfare. You can see all the confusion going on in the world. You know, that's why it's important, you know, to have Jesus in your life and be on the right side. But going back to what I see, maybe it is to see, that's a wake me up, you know, this is real, this is not a joke. You know, I was too prideful. I thought I'd figured out, but it humbled me in a way. And, you know, that's when gradually over time, I just felt the Bible calling me, you know, the need to pick it up, and which I did, and listening to different sermons online, the word started really to dwell on me. You know, and that's when in November, I just laid it all down, surrendered, not being half in, half out, lukewarm, you know, just going all in, and that's when I got convicted from head to toe. You know, and at the same time, he convicted me, he filled me up with the Holy Spirit, and, you know, with that has come peace, joy, love, self-control, discernment. You know, it says a good shepherd will always come back for that one last sheep, and there I am today.
Have you confessed of your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes, I have.
And do you promise, with God's help and the help of his people, to live a life that is worthy of
him? I do, yes.
Come in. Trainers off, put socks on. There you go. figure that one out. There you go. Nathan also is a big lad. Well, Nathan, because you have confessed your sins and put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and that you have requested this, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Guys that have been baptized here today come from all walks of life. We've got kids who've been brought up in Christian homes. We've got people who are long-distance lorry drivers who've gone away from the faith and come back to the faith. We've got MMA fighters who've been taken out of the fighting world to come and to serve God in different ways. We've got an ex-opera singer that has been baptized. We've got a painter and decorator from London who came to faith over the internet through his cousin's words. I think I've covered that. Oh, someone who came out of a darkness and depression to see the wonder and the truth and the beauty of the Lord Jesus Christ. God saves his people, and God brings his people to himself through the Lord Jesus Christ from all manner of backgrounds, all walks of life, and uses all situations. So if you've been listening to these stories and these accounts, and something is stirring in your heart, let me just tell you a little story from the Bible. There's a story in Acts, and there's an Ethiopian who is going from Jerusalem back to Ethiopia, and he comes across a disciple, Philip. And the Ethiopian is engaging with the scriptures of the Old Testament. And he asks Philip, okay, what's going on here? And Philip explains to him, it says that Philip actually told him all the good news about the Lord Jesus Christ. And they traveled along the way while Philip told him more about the gospel. And they get to some water. And the eunuch, the Ethiopian eunuch, asks and says, well, here's water, what stops me from being baptized? And the answer was nothing. So they went down to the water and Philip baptized him there and then. If you know the Lord Jesus Christ, if you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you want to be baptized, please, we would ask, come speak to us. If you want to be baptized today, and it's appropriate and right for you to be baptized today, then we would like to baptize you. The guys are going to sing a song in a minute. And during that song, there'll be myself will be here, Steve will be here, Ben will be here, we'll be at the front, Luke will be here. If you want to talk to us about baptism, come and have a chat with us. And we would love to baptize you. So can I invite you all to sing as I pray? And then stand as I pray. Don't sing as I pray, because you won't be able to hear me. That'd be weird. It'd be kind of rude. Let me pray and then we'll sing. Father, thank you so much that we get to do this, that we get to see your work in people's lives. Thank you for all the different people that you call to yourself. Thank you that we get to be a part of your people. Thank you for the goodness and the grace that you've shown us, that your character that we've just been hearing about is clearly displayed through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we who trust and believe in you have new life. Father, thank you. Father, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit, and we pray for your help to walk forward as your people, glorifying you, and we praise you. We praise you with the words that we sing, and we praise you with our whole lives now. Amen. Let's sing.
I was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I hear you call. Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own, I had no right to draw near your throne. Father, you loved me still, and in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. You have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. You left your home to seek out the lost. You knew the great and terrible cost. But Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to the bone. Nothing I did could ever atone. Jesus, you paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. A handful of rocks and all made of stone. Spirit, you moved in me. Now your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven's sin is in my grace and grace alone. So I stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run the race by grace and grace alone. I will slay my sin by grace and grace alone. I will reach the end by grace and grace alone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest shroud and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when strife is still.
Amen. Amen. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom belong glory forever and ever. Amen. Let me pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you that because of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are those who are alive, and that you are a faithful God who watches over us like a good shepherd who looks after his sheep. And we praise you that we can celebrate your goodness this morning, knowing that you are a God who's got our back, and that you in your goodness and your grace are using us. And Lord, our prayer is that you equip us to do your will as we head into this week, that we would see more men and women and children around us proclaiming the name of Jesus, because that is what they were created to do. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for your goodness and your kindness in showing us tangibly that you are a God who raises the dead. So we praise you for that this morning, and we pray that into this week that you would bless us, that you would make your face shine upon us, and that, Lord, your name would be glorified in every moment of our lives, because our lives are all about you. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Good to see you all. Great to gather together this morning. If you are new and you want to connect into the life of the church, either speak to myself or remember the Connect team, or grab one of our Connect cards and we will help you connect into the life of the church. Other than that, have a great week. God bless.